It is so good to have you here on this wonderful Sunday morning. Let's take a moment to go to our God in prayer and thank Him for this wonderful day. Heavenly Father, we thank you for the opportunity to share once again as we've gathered in your name to praise you for all of the goodness that you've given to us in life. Now, Lord, I ask that you would bless each person who has come here to open their heart and their mind to listen to your word and to gather in praise and honor of you around your table and remember the great sacrifice that you gave for us. And so, Lord, we have come together to honor you and thank you for that wonderful gift of life. And now, Lord, we ask your blessing upon this service, for it is in Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Once again, thank you for being here. Let's sing together our next hymn of praise, Alleluia.
Hallelujah.
we come to that part of our service that we pause out of our lives to come once again to remember the sacrifice that Christ made for us. Let's stand as we prepare our hearts and our minds for a word of prayer. And then we invite you to partake of your communion anytime during the singing of our song. There's just something about that name.
Please help all the victims of the earthquakes. Please give them comfort. Lord, we pray that we will fulfill our unique God-given purpose this week. We pray that we can share your truths and to strive to help America be a better Christian nation. We thank you that we need to not worry, but can pray, because only you have control of any difficult situations. We thank you for Pastor Alton's message this week, and pray that we will act in accordance with the meaning of those words. Jesus, we pray that our federal and state governments will do what is honest, fair, and good for Christianity, America, and our world. Jesus, we honor and glorify you, and as we take this communion, we reflect on how you gave of your body and blood for our grace. You suffered at the hands of not only your enemies, but also your friends too. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen.
Let me thank you for being here, all of you. Such a wonderful day. Rather chilly outside this morning, but it's so good to have you here. All of you are aware that we have continued to record our Sunday morning services every week since we started that way back in, what was it, 2020 now? During our time that we took off for a few weeks because the world scared us to death. But We actually have now an off-campus congregation, I guess is what I would call them, who watch our worship online service on a regular basis. And I guess I can call them a congregation. They don't congregate, except maybe through the video, but they are faithful people and do watch our services, and many of those faithful people help Norco Christian Church a great deal by sending their offerings to us every month. And so for that reason, for those faithful, I spend 2 days of every week, in addition to Sundays, editing, rendering, uploading those videos, setting up cameras, charging batteries, reformatting memory cards, solving problems with my cameras, and a host of other things, so that you can continue to be a part of our wonderful congregation here. Some of the videos that I record from my cameras on Sundays don't always render properly. And sometimes they won't render at all. And sometimes those frustrating times cause me to have to spend more time than I had hoped to spend. This week was one of those weeks. And so I brought home one of the cameras this week to try to adjust some settings that might help the situation. Usually those adjustments are often hit and miss, and sometimes they will solve a problem, more often they will not. Again, this week was one of those weeks. I was working in the den one evening this week where Pat was watching television. I was trying to make some adjustments to some of the equipment. Some of the settings on the dials are rather small, as Mike and Tom will confirm for me. Pat saw me working on the camera in the dim light of the den, and in her tenderheartedness, she asked me if I wanted the light on. I agreed that it might help somewhat, so she graciously turned it on in spite of the fact that she was still watching a television show. However, given the fact that I was working on something rather small, when she turned the light on, I discovered something rather interesting. As you would expect, there was more light in the entire room. However, because I was working in small spaces, I noticed, although there was more light, that light shined into my eyes directly and cast more shadows, which made it even more difficult to see the small things I was trying to see. At that moment, I decided to go get the real light. No more of this overhead stuff. Now, the real light that I'm referring to is the light that Rudy Kozak had graciously purchased for me not long after all of us almost getting caught in the darkness of the narrows of Zion several years ago. This light has an almost 1,000 lumens of light coming from an LED headlamp that I sometimes use to hike or take walks with at night. However, it is so bright that I have to turn down the brightness to keep it from being too bright. And so I strapped that headlamp around my head and turned it on. And now I could direct the light exactly where I wanted it to be. And voila, I could see all those little things. That's what we need to get you, Mike.
Yeah.
and Tom. A nice headlamp. Maybe you could see those little dials. You have one. All right. Maybe we should put it to use. I want to share with you this morning a passage of Scripture and a message that I have entitled, Gift, the Water of Life. We have received life from the light. As I have read through John, I have noticed how often Jesus talks about light. I've preached several sermons about light just from the book of John. And here we are again, Jesus telling us about the light of the world. Our scripture begins in John 12, today at verse 36. Now you will remember, if you've been in service the last few weeks, that we are now studying the last week of Christ's life. Jesus is speaking to a very large crowd of people who have come to Jerusalem for the Passover feast. God's timing here is not random. God's timing for the death of Jesus is very specifically planned around the Passover feast. Jesus has come to be their true Passover. All the Passover that had gone before was only a picture of what Jesus would do for us. They had celebrated this Passover feast for hundreds of years. It was a picture of Jesus, the true Passover. And now Jesus says, put your trust in the light while you have it, so that you may become sons of the light. When he had finished speaking, Jesus left and hid himself from them. Even after Jesus had done all these miraculous signs in their presence, they still would not believe in him. This was to fulfill the word of Isaiah the prophet. Lord, who has believed our message, and to whom has the arm of the Lord been revealed? For this reason they could not believe, because as Isaiah says elsewhere, he has blinded their eyes and deadened their hearts, so they can neither see with their eyes nor understand with their hearts, nor turn, and I would heal them. Isaiah said this because he saw Jesus' glory and spoke about him. Yet at the same time, many, even among the leaders, believed in him. But because of the Pharisees, they would not confess their sin for fear. They would not confess their faith, rather, for fear they would be put out of the synagogue. For they loved praise from men more than praise from God. Then Jesus cried out, when a man believes in me, he does not believe in me only, but in the one who sent me. When he looks at me, he sees the one who sent me. I have come into the world as a light, so that no one who believes in me should stay in darkness. As for the person who hears my words but does not keep them, I do not judge him. For I did not come into the world to judge, but to save it. There is a judge for the one who rejects me and does not accept my words. That very word which I spoke will condemn him on the last day. For I did not speak of my own accord, but the Father who sent me commanded me what to say and how to say it, I know that his command leads to eternal life. So whatever I say is just what the Father has told me to say. Gift, the water of life. We have received life through the light. Three things that help us stay away from the darkness, stay out of the darkness. Three things that help keep us out of that darkness, the darkness of the world. Number one, knowing the past. We cannot prepare correctly for the present or the future without knowing something about the past. History provides the only information about what we don't know about the future. God's people from the past saw the glory of God through the light. The Old Testament prophet saw the glory of God by the light. Isaiah had written and had preached in his day. John tells us with the words, "Lord, who has believed our message and to whom has the arm of the Lord been revealed?" Now that is not only recorded here for us in John, it is the first verse of Isaiah chapter 53. Isaiah chapter 53 is an important chapter in our Bible. The message of the 53rd chapter of Isaiah actually begins in chapter 52. It describes the sufferings of Christ in very specific ways. In the 11th verse of Isaiah 53, Isaiah says, "After the suffering of his soul, he will see the light of life and be satisfied." There Isaiah implies, I believe, the resurrection of Christ after his sufferings. His resurrection is the means by which we know we have received life through the light. John now interprets for us. He says they couldn't believe. What John meant by that statement was they couldn't believe because they wouldn't. They couldn't believe because their hearts were hard. Their minds were calloused. They couldn't override the stubbornness of their heart. And so John quotes, he has blinded their eyes and deadened their hearts so they can neither see with their eyes nor understand with their hearts nor turn, and I would heal them. What John implies here is how overwhelmingly God wants to heal us if we will only open our hearts. But part of the solution is left to our human will and our willing heart. In the Hebrew mindset, this poetic expression would have been a way of God saying to them, "I want so badly to heal them, but they will not come to me so that I can." A doctor may want to heal your sick body, but if you don't go to him, there's nothing he can do about it. And John tells us that Isaiah said this because he saw Jesus' glory and spoke about him. I went to my orthopedic doctor this week. This was my fourth visit with him since he did surgery on my fractured leg over a year ago. Every time he comes into the room, he asks me, "How are you doing?" That would I guess, be a logical question for a doctor to ask you. And every time I answer him the way I did when I woke up from surgery on December 28th, 2021, I'm happy on my way to heaven. And every time, his response has always been the same. He just smiles and gives a soft laugh, as if to say, "Yes, don't you wish?" But it is true that when our minds and hearts are open to the light of the world, we know his command leads us to eternal life. Those are the words of Jesus in verse 50. Those are not my words. His command leads to eternal life. Gift the water of life, we have received life from the light. The second thing that helps keep us out of the darkness is by embracing the present. Now, the Jewish leaders saw the glory of God through the light of the world. However, their faith did not take them far enough. The scripture says many of them believed. But here's where the rubber meets the road. You have heard me say that it is as important to believe Jesus as it is to believe in him. It is interesting to look at John's words carefully. He says, "Yet at the same time, many even among the leaders believed in him." Now, if you have watched the Chosen series, you know that evidently Nicodemus, in his heart, is in this boat. But because of the Pharisees, they would not confess their faith for fear they would be put out of the synagogue. For they loved praise from men more than praise from God. It was fear that kept them from responding to Christ, even though they believed in him. It was fear that kept them from confessing their faith, even though they believed in him. Now, don't take the fear they had lightly. Understandably, this was a legitimate fear. If the Pharisees found out that a member of the leadership had confessed his faith in Jesus, that leader would not only lose his place of leadership, he would get completely kicked out of the synagogue. In fact, any member of the synagogue who would get kicked out, whether he was a leader or not, if he were caught believing in Jesus, if any member of the synagogue were caught confessing their faith, they would be disbarred from any activity of the synagogue. And you would find it difficult to make a living. And you would be like Matthew, perhaps. You may have to get a job with the Romans. And then you could be thoroughly despised by your own kind. Now, let me take a minute to explain some different levels of faith. I've listed these levels like this because I think that is what John does here in this illustration. There is the first level, and that's believing in Jesus. But there is a second level that I call believing Jesus. Believing in Jesus means that you believe that he exists and that he was who he said he was. He was the Son of God. That's what it means to believe in Jesus. And you might rightly ask, well, isn't that good enough? Isn't that what God wants us to do, believe in him as the Son of God? Doesn't God want us to believe in Jesus as the Messiah come to earth? Isn't that what Christmas is all about? And I celebrate Christmas every year. Now, if you think believing in Christ as the Son of God is all we need to do to get to heaven, then answer this question for me. What did John mean when he wrote in verse 42, "Yet at the same time, many, even among the leaders, believed in him, but because of the Pharisees, they would not confess their faith for fear that they would be put out of the synagogue, for they loved praise from men more than praise from God." John emphatically indicates by what he says here that just believing that Christ existed and came to earth at Christmas time is insufficient. So that brings us to the question, what is the difference between believing in Jesus and believing Jesus? Believing in him means I believe that he exists. Or that he did exist at one time. I believe he was who he said he was. But to believe Jesus means that I believe that he will do what he promised if I confess my faith in him. And that goes beyond just believing in him. Confessing our faith in him means we are willing to follow him. With those thoughts in mind, here's what happened. If one of the members or leaders of the synagogue were to get kicked out of the synagogue, one summer, 3 or 4 years ago, I received a phone call while I was on vacation from someone I did not know. As far as he could tell, he had never met me. But he had a paper with my name on it. The paper that he had was an early version of a memory system that I developed on the book of Acts. We have studied that course in the past, and I hope to again when we finish our Chosen series. I was on vacation at the time, and I had just exited City Market grocery store in Montrose, Colorado. The man began to tell me a little about himself and asked me if I had ever finished the memory course because his copy went only through chapter 18. But in the course of conversation, he told me that he had been kicked out of 9 churches in his lifetime. He didn't tell me exactly why, but I think he believed it was because he thought he knew more than they did, and they didn't like him in their church for that reason. And maybe that was true, but I wondered if what he told me as much about himself as it did about the 9 churches he'd been kicked out of. In today's world, it is not often someone gets kicked out of a church. Being kicked out of the synagogue, however, was a more severe punishment than being kicked out of a church today, I'm sure. If you got kicked out of the synagogue in Jesus' day, you must have most certainly have been prepared to lose your job. If you had your own business, you would lose 90% of your clientele. You may well lose many of the members of your family. Getting kicked out of the synagogue meant that you would have to begin a whole new life. Everything you knew in the past that offered security for you would be gone in one swoop of faith in Jesus. And you would have to believe Jesus at that point. You would have to depend on trusting that he would take care of you. You would certainly have to alter your anchor of trust. So you can understand where the fear came from. So they would not confess their faith for fear. And then John adds, for they love the praise of men more than the praise of God. That was a tough slot canyon to be in, or what we might call being between a rock and a hard place. What John's expectation for the one who believed in him, what was his expectation? His expectation was for those who believed in Jesus to also believe Jesus and confess their faith in him, even though it meant being persecuted for it. And then in the midst of that persecution, to believe that Jesus would take care of it all in the end. And we could still say, I'm happy on my way to heaven. And the third thing that keeps us out of the darkness is living for the future. Everyone who sees the glory of God must come to him through the light. Now, in verse 44, John records for us, then Jesus cried out. It is interesting that John tells us that Jesus cried out. Jesus did not speak softly or timidly when he cried out. He cried out. That means he shouted. When a man believes in me, he also believes in the one who sent me. When he looks at me, he sees the one who sent me. In other words, when they looked at Jesus, they would see God. As for the person who hears my words, but does not keep them, my words will judge him. Even though I came into the world to save it, to save his life. For the person who hears my words but does not keep them, I do not judge him, for I did not come to judge the world but to save it. Jesus yearns to save our soul, to save our life, to save our mind. And yet, there were those who would not turn. And so Jesus says, there is a judge for the one who rejects me and does not accept my words. That very word which I speak will condemn him at the last day. For I did not speak of my own accord, but the Father who sent me commanded me what to say and how to say it. I know this command leads to eternal life. So whatever I say is just what the Father has told me to say. After my experience the other night with different lights, I began to think about how the world thinks. The world has the idea that they have a new light. They have shed light on society. The world thinks they have shed light on everyone. And I guess they have, if you watch your television. Television sheds lights on it. They really do believe that they have turned on a new light for you. They think they have discovered some new idea or created some new philosophy or some new element of thought. The world thinks they have turned on a new light by crossing new barriers of morality. They hail to the world by telling people they have turned on a new light. The problem with the light that comes from the world is this. The world's light often lights up everything that God doesn't want lit up. It casts a bright light in our eyes. It fools us into thinking that things are brighter now. What it really does is cast shadows in the smaller corners of life so that we cannot see what we really need to see. Not until we believe Jesus and put on the real light that we can see all the wonderful corners and the precious recesses of life and experience the things that cannot be seen otherwise. It is invitation time. Are you willing to go that extra step beyond believing in Jesus to believe him? Declare the depths of his love. We have been saved by the light of the world. Let's stand as we bow our heads for a word of prayer, and then we're going to sing our invitation hymn, Shine, Jesus, Shine. Heavenly Father, we thank you for your precious grace and pray that you will motivate us, fill us with your love and the expectation of believing you to do for us the things that you have promised. And so we bring our life this morning before you as we make decisions to allow you to guide and shine upon our life. For it is in Jesus' name I pray. Amen. If you have a decision to make for Christ, come as we sing together. Shine, Jesus, shine.
Light of the world, sign upon us, set us free.
You may be seated. Two or three things I want to remind you about Wednesday night Bible study. We will try to leave the doors unlocked. Somebody got locked out Wednesday night because I closed the door behind me. I didn't realize it was locked. Somebody else had opened it up, and Bob came, and we'd already started, and we didn't hear him knock. So so he went home. Come Wednesday night, we'll promise to leave the doors unlocked. March 5th, Joe Grana will be here to talk to us from Hope International University. Dave Sawkins will be here the following Sunday on the 12th to speak to us. Dave is from DS Ministries, and if you were here the last time he was here, you know how many things he is involved in. And so that's where your mission money is going, a couple of places. And then we have missions in Japan and in Africa. So I hope that you'll plan to be a part of our victory offering this year. You'll share some special gift above and beyond your regular giving in that. We hope to be able at the end of March to share some very special offerings with our missionaries. And so keep that in mind. And then board meeting for all of you board members right after service today. So those are the three things that I have at this time. I think that's all I have. So let's stand and sing together our closing song. I've got a mansion over here. Thank you. bless you. Have a wonderful week.